Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. So delighted that you are here. My name is John Costello, and I have the distinct pleasure and honor of introducing you to the Isaac Consumer Lecture Award winner for this year. And even more, I have had the incredible honor to be part of this award from its inception. And so I would love to take a few minutes before I formally introduce our speaker to tell you about the award, to tell you about how it's come about and the history of the award. So first of all, the vision. What has been the vision for this award? Well, I have to tell you that this award started because of the vision of Walton Ginger Waltos from Words Plus, who almost 25 years ago now had said, there's something that we have to do to recognize the fact that there are so many extraordinary individuals who use augmentative communication who, despite being extraordinary people, are constantly looked at by many people for the tool they're using, the strategy they're using. And people are asked constantly to talk about their augmentative communication techniques and their woes, perhaps. And while obviously that life history is rich and important, it doesn't represent the totality of who people are. And so early on, the focus was, we don't want to ask people to limit themselves to talking about their AAC experience, to talking about how augmentative communication has changed their life, despite our being all passionate about AAC, or about someone's life with a disability. Instead, what we really wanted to be able to do is highlight people's talents, their strengths, their expertise, their scholarly endeavors, and really allow people a platform that is all too often not provided to communicate this and express their opinions and their expertise. So this lecture started back in 92, and I'll tell you a little bit about how the process has worked. So there have been submissions that have been published in Isaac Publications, or requests for submissions that have been published, and it's been specifically detailed what it is and what it is not. And I say that because we have done everything possible to stay true to the vision that I've just described. And so those guidelines are published, and up to, and now, because we have such a long history, we can have up to four previous recipients of this award be part of the judgment committee. This year, we had had 11 submissions from four different countries. And so we were had a pretty difficult time because there were a number of real quality submissions, although I think you will agree that everyone made the right choice. I didn't change something in the slide that I should have. I'm following Jeff Riley's pattern here. So that should say now Canadian 5,000, not US 5,000. Who better to emulate than you, Jeff, right? So in addition to this extraordinary platform, the recipient of this award receives $5,000 Canadian to support their participation or whatever they would like. So I wanted to give you some insight into the rich legacy and very quickly talk about people who've presented before and let you kind of see some information about their topics. So on Mick Joyce, in 1992, Mick Joyce had talked about finding love in relationships in the 20th century. Paul Marshall in 94, value of faith and family. It's kind of exciting, by the way, because a number of previous presenters are right here. Michael Williams in 96, Literacy and Education, A Foundation to Success. Meredith Allen, 98. I think Meredith might be here. Feminism, Language, and Culture. Heather Rose Slattery in 2000, writing and starring in a provocative film that was honored at the Cannes Film Festival. Solomon Rockman in 2002, the opportunities in a communistic versus democratic governance in society. Sayamdul Mukherjee in 2004, who presented on spirituality realized through nature, and he particularly reflected on his trek through the Himalayas. Yusun Chung in 2006, Motherhood, the Greatest Life Achievement. India Oaks, 2008. To be or not to be, using our rights and supporting our world, a real focus on human rights issues. Tor Sandmel, 2010, Philosophy of Mathematics. Lisa Lehman in 2012, Intimacy as a Human Need. So it gives me such great pleasure to introduce our lecturer for today. However, before we do, I'm not stressing you out, am I? No. Before we do, just a little bit. Before we do, remember we have asked people to make sure you download your photos so they can be shared with everybody? So there's very few opportunities to have a photo of most of our delegates. So on three, look thrilled to be here. And wave. One, two, three. Okay, I think that did it. Get closer together. It always is an Australian. So, there's one in every crowd. There's actually a bunch. So, I'm actually going to do a panorama. How's that? So, yeah. We will get this and here we go, here we go, here we go, and done. That's right. I am so thrilled to introduce to you Fiona Given from Australia. Fiona's presentation today is spectacular. I can tell you that from great authority. I also want to tell you that we're very thankful to Liberator, who had, in a pinch of just a little bit of a challenge we had, stepped right in and addressed that. But that will also explain to you why Fiona of Australia sounds a bit like Fiona of London. Fiona's topic, A Journey of Discovery to the Last Frontier, Discovering an Adventure in Antarctica. Didn't quite look like Antarctica. Just got to get that Australian thing in every minute, don't you? So
bon dia, good day, hello. Firstly, I would like to say What a privilege it is to be giving this lecture. I would like to thank my peers for selecting me. You are all a great inspiration to me, and it is a great honor to be part of your club. During this lecture, I would like you to think about what inspirational experience you really want in your life. It does not have to be elaborate. I will leave it there and come back to it at the end. In order to set the stage, to let you know who I am and what brings me to where I am today, I would like to give you a quick rundown of my medical and educational history. My life was an adventure from the beginning. I came into this world deprived of oxygen, resulting in cerebral palsy, a lifetime condition involving significant mobility and speech difficulties. Yes, the beginnings of a lifetime struggle, but also the beginnings of a lifetime adventure. I was born in the southwestern suburbs of Sydney, where my parents had lived for most of their lives to that point. Within 18 months, we moved to Canberra, Australia's capital city, because of my father's work, and this is where my brother, Scott, was born. After a couple of years, we returned to Sydney again because of my father's work, but with an intent that my physical development issues and educational needs were addressed as appropriately as possible. Relatively early in my childhood, and with the encouragement of my parents, I came to the realization that I needed to speak up for myself, figuratively speaking, if I was going to be able to maximize opportunities for my social, physical, and educational development. This did not always endear me to those running the Spastic Center special school in Sydney, which I initially attended, and later the special disability support unit at a local government primary school. When I was 12, I campaigned hard to be fully integrated into mainstream schooling, even writing to the government Minister for Education. And the following year, achieved my ambition to be accepted as a student at a mainstream high school. I knew this was essential in order for me to have any chance at pursuing a fulfilling career. One of the reasons it was so contentious was that the school had to make significant modifications to provide wheelchair access, including the installation of a lift. I ultimately won that battle and attended Riverside Girls High School, completing my higher school certificate in 1997. I achieved sufficient marks to gain entry into my desired university course, Arts, Law. The irony of this story is that one of the Department of Education officials who advocated for the lift to be installed is now one of my work colleagues. This historical connection was only realized when we were chatting at work one day. The thirst for adventure, particularly involving travel and new experiences, was instilled in me from childhood. My parents were always taking me on holiday trips, be it within our home state of New South Wales or further afield. These places included metropolitan and country Victoria, Queensland, Tasmania, and South Australia. In 1998, I was selected to represent my university at a conference for students with disability, which involved a 5-hour flight across to Western Australia. Last year, I completed the final piece in the puzzle when my mother and I went to Alice Springs and Uluru in the Northern Territory. So I can now say I have been to every state and territory in Australia. My parents also took me on some real adventure holidays overseas. One of the most memorable was our 3-month camper van trip in Europe when I was 10 and my brother 8 years old. That was when my father nicknamed our family the Griswolds, after the family from National Lampoon's European Vacation. It was truly crazy, from being driven along the amazingly beautiful Amalfi coast in Italy, hanging on for dear life while we negotiated those outrageous hairpin bends, to being stopped by angry government soldiers in the former Yugoslavia. As an adult, I realize this was an amazing feat by my parents. During my high school years, I played the sport of boxer and was fortunate enough to be selected to represent Australia. This involved travel to international competitions, including the 1996 Paralympics in Atlanta. In fact, the first international competition I attended was the World Cup held here in Portugal at Coimbra. I was only 13 and was the proud Aussie flag bearer. This ended up being my best performance, finishing fifth. After narrowly missing, going through to the semi-finals by 1 point on a tiebreaker. It is great to be back in Portugal. University, where I attained my arts law degree, presented more travel opportunities. I wanted an adventure, so I decided to go on exchange for a semester to the University of Calgary in Canada, where I studied political science, which was my arts major. I lived on campus, and as it gradually got colder and colder, I had to rug up just to get to class without getting frostbite. Yes, I must like cold places. Another adventure presented itself when I had finished university and started working. This again involved living overseas. I saw a job advertised for an intern lawyer with a disability to spend 3 months working at the International Legal Center for Human Rights, based in London. I decided to apply, not expecting to be successful. I got the job. As you can imagine, organizing accommodation and support services presented some interesting challenges. However, I enjoyed working with people from all over the world and learning about their plights. My travels and adventures have taken me to 28 different countries throughout the world, not including some of the amazing places I have visited on this trip, and I am not done yet. As Hans Christian Andersen said, to travel is to live. As human beings, it's within our instincts to seek adventure. If we look at the early explorers, their yearning for adventure led to discoveries of many amazing parts of the world. Being here in Portugal reminds me of the bravery and adventurous spirit of famous explorers, such as Ferdinand Magellan, who led the first expedition to circumnavigate the Earth, Vasco da Gama, first to sail directly from Europe to India, and Bartholomew Diaz, who discovered the Cape of Good Hope. It is claimed that early Portuguese explorers were the first to sight Australia in the early 16th century. Equally inspiring, but centuries later, were those explorers of the world's most remote region, Antarctica. The exploits of Scott, Shackleton, and Mawson spring to mind. Adventure can mean different things to different people. Mark Twain said, 20 years from now, you will be more disappointed by the things that you didn't do than by the ones you did do. So throw off the bow lines. Sail away from the safe harbor. Catch the trade winds in your sails. Explore. Dream. Discover. I think the following quote from my favorite poet, Robert Frost, also sums up adventure really well. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Wikipedia, being the 21st century's authority on everything, defines adventure as an exciting or unusual experience. It may also be a bold, usually risky, undertaking with an uncertain outcome. I was surprised when I read the Wikipedia entry because it basically sums up my entire life. However, going to Antarctica was perhaps the most adventurous because it seemed out of reach and turned out to be possible. I have had a fascination with Antarctica for many years. I think it began when I visited an Antarctica museum in Tasmania when I was 9 years old. What attracted me to Antarctica was that it seemed completely out of reach, and for some strange reason, I enjoyed challenges. As I am naturally a very determined person, once I decide that I'm going to do something, I generally work hard to make it happen. My determination to go to Antarctica was set well before I actually set sail. In Australia, Qantas Airline schedules one-day flights over Antarctica. So when I finished school, I found half-price tickets on the internet and convinced my mother and my auntie this would be a cool thing to do. I think Mum thought that it would cure my Antarctic bug. We did the flight, which was amazing. You can see much more from the air than I expected. The pre-flight safety briefing was slightly different to the standard one. We were instructed to put on all the clothes we had with us in the unlikely event that we would need to exit the aircraft. I instantly thought of the tragic event when an Air New Zealand Antarctic Joy flight crashed into Mount Erebus in 1979, killing all passengers. An Antarctica expert was on board to demonstrate all the essential clothing needed in Antarctica and to answer questions. We also tried on the gear. I recall saying to my mother and aunt on the way back to Sydney after seeing the spectacle from the air, I have to go back by ship and walk on this great white continent. Their response was too expensive and too difficult. Mum had said she would not go because she gets seasick. Antarctica does not have an airport or hotels. The only way for tourists to get there is by ship across some of the roughest seas in the world. And yet, it is still possible for tourists to go. $1.5 million people visit each year. So I thought, why can't I? I did not want to go to prove anything. I just wanted to see the most magical place on earth. Given that my mother could not travel with me, I patiently waited for that magical day when that special someone came along who also yearned for adventure. Dreams come true when you least expect it. A good friend of mine and I had been planning a trip to Europe. We were thinking of going to Germany and Italy. However, as we had both been to those places before, we decided we should go somewhere different. My friend came over to my home one Saturday, armed with an atlas, ready to plan an overseas trip. She posed the question, if you could go anywhere in the world, where would you go? Without hesitation, I said, Antarctica. Without hesitation, she said, I agree. Fortunately, I also managed to convince another friend to join us on our adventure. I wrote to a well-known Australian adventurer, Dick Smith, to ask for some advice on how to make this trip happen. He recommended I talk to the owners of Adventure Travel Company, Aurora Expeditions. As it turned out, this was extremely good advice, as the company was very understanding of my particular needs and difficulties. We were advised by our chosen travel company to go via Argentina because it is the shortest sea passage, the Drake Passage. We were also advised to do the 11-night cruise that went to the Antarctic Peninsula and the Weddell Sea. Unfortunately, this meant we missed out on seeing king penguins. However, it ensured that we had the shortest passage to cross. We sailed from Ushuaia a picturesque town at the southern end of Argentina. Our vessel, the Polar Pioneer, was a small expedition ship holding only 56 passengers plus 23 crew, vastly different from a luxury cruise liner. The crossing is extremely rough. Sick bags lined the ship's corridors, and my wheelchair had to be wedged between the dining table and the wall to prevent it from flying across the room whilst I was in it. It was quite scary, constantly worrying about my own safety and the safety of others. Fellow passengers and crew were always prepared to lend a hand. Seeing waves lap at the portholes on the third deck was a bit unnerving. I was filled with anticipation as to what Antarctica would be like. This is also about friendship. In the end, the three of us, travel companions, truly relied equally on each other to get through the 4-week trip. Whilst we were in Buenos Aires, we found ourselves in a few rough areas. The hostel. The hostel where we initially booked for the entire time we were in Buenos Aires was in a particularly rough part of town. I am proud to say that we have remained friends and will be so forever. I think you'll learn a lot about your friends when you travel with them and go through adversity together, as well as sharing extraordinary experiences like riding in a Zodiac boat. Antarctica is a very special place because it is one of the few places on Earth which has not yet been impacted too much by humans. The wildlife is not intimidated by humans at all. I remember one curious chin strap penguin came up to me as if to say, "Who are you and what are you doing here?" There is nothing like seeing animals in their natural environment. I particularly enjoyed watching the penguins getting up to their antics. For example, the Gentoo penguins, the ones with the orange beaks, like to empire build by stealing rocks from each other. It is a real status symbol, to have the greatest number of rocks. Since being to Antarctica, I no longer believe in zoos or other animal enclosures. I went to the penguin enclosure at SeaWorld on Queensland's Gold Coast, and I felt really uncomfortable, as this was a far cry from the natural environment. Antarctica presented many challenges and adventures. For example, upon arrival to the British base of Port Lockroy, I was looking up from the zodiac at the steep rock face, thinking, how on earth will I get up here? The crew managed to haul me and my wheelchair up the rocks and into the base so I could post my postcards. I think I was more nervous on the way back down, expecting to crash any second. Antarctica is the coldest and driest continent on Earth. It can be an extremely harsh environment. There is only a short window of opportunity between November and March. During summer in the Southern Hemisphere, when tourists can actually visit Antarctica, because the weather during winter is too harsh for human beings. Unless you are Don and Margie McIntyre, an Australian couple who, in 1995, were brave enough to spend a year alone on this unforgiving continent. Unlike scientists based in research stations, the McIntyres lived in a tiny hut chained to the rocks, with winds that sometimes exceeded 240 kilometers an hour and wind chill temperatures as low as minus 80 degrees Celsius. I got a brief glimpse of how harsh this environment can be whilst on Deception Island. Deception Island is covered in volcanic ash and has red, round tin huts where whale blubber was stored between 1912 and 1931. We were walking around the island, looking at the various huts and having a sing-along, because the acoustics inside the huts were amazing. Suddenly, a storm kicks up with wind and sleet. Ash was blowing everywhere. I also recall it being bitterly cold, even though the ship doctor had put a hot water bottle down my back. We had to get back to the ship in a hurry before the seas got too rough for the zodiacs. The small boats that were used to attend us from the ship to the land. I was trying to imagine what it must have been like for the likes of Shackleton in those very early days of Antarctic exploration. I know you have all been thinking about Antarctica and the environment. And it would be remiss of me to discuss my grand Antarctic adventure without mentioning its impact on my perceptions of the world's climate change challenges. I recall sitting on the ship's bridge one afternoon. There was dead silence. Everyone was in awe of the spectacle that was happening before them. It was still daylight, as the sun does not set until very late in Antarctica during summer. Nothing at all was moving, even the passengers were still. The water was as calm as a mill pond. There was a backdrop of a massive wall of ice. The feeling was like being in a church of nature. It was one of the most awesome feelings I have ever had. Really spiritual, but at the same time, I was conscious of the fact that we could lose this special place of natural beauty. It also reminded me of how insignificant we all are and how precious our planet is.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? Saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
As I left my beloved Antarctica and sailed north on the Drake Passage back to Ushuaia, I felt satisfied that I had realized one of my ultimate dreams, to set foot on the great white continent. Russian crew member Sergei carried me off the ship once again, back on terra firma. Global warming is particularly concerning in relation to its effect on Antarctica. It is slowly being melted away. While we were safely sitting on the ship's bridge, we witnessed many instances of ice breaking away from the glaciers. Even more dramatic was the occasion when our Zodiac had to steer clear of a glacier because a large piece of ice fell off, causing waves beneath us. According to the British Antarctic Survey, the Antarctic Peninsula has warmed 3 degrees in 50 years, causing ice shelves to retreat further and further south. There is no better way to demonstrate the profound impact global warming has on Antarctica than the documentary An Inconvenient Truth, starring Al Gore. This, then, begs the question: is Antarctic tourism a good thing or a bad thing? On the one hand, it increases the human impact on the historically untouched environment. On the other hand, it increases environmental awareness when visiting such a fragile, raw landscape. My personal environmental awareness has definitely increased since being in Antarctica. Sadly, we are ruining Antarctica, and the ice is melting. If you have the desire to go to Antarctica, I would urge you to go now, so that you can see the impact on the environment for yourself. I am sure you will become a committed conservationist if you are not one already. Of course, global warming is not just about melting ice, as demonstrated by the recent bushfires in Australia. Portugal and Spain have also experienced severe bushfires. Are you aware of the fact that in Australia and parts of the United States, there have been fires in recent years, with fewer and fewer years between the periods of fire? Bushfires are prevalent during the hot summer months. On the 16th of January this year, the Australian Climate Change Council released a report stating heat waves are becoming more frequent, hotter, and are lasting longer because of climate change. Bushfires are commonplace in Australia, especially during summer. I was part of a team of solicitors who worked on litigation relating to the 2003 Canberra bushfires, and I will never forget the damage they caused. There were 160,000 hectares burnt, almost 500 homes were destroyed, and 4 people lost their lives. There was a massive bushfire in New South Wales in October last year. There were bushfires burning in the Blue Mountains just west of Sydney, as well as bushfires in the Hunter and Port Macquarie, north of Sydney. Over 100,000 hectares were burnt and at least 248 buildings were destroyed across the state. I hope my fire and ice theme has not sounded like a story of doom and gloom. I am optimistic about the future of the world and the capacity of our adventurous spirit to be a positive influence. Going back to my initial question, what do you want in your life? The world is your oyster. Whatever it is important to realize that nothing is stopping you from achieving it. There are solutions to most barriers. And in the end, life is not measured by the number of breaths we take, but by the moments that take our breath away. Antarctica certainly took my breath away, both literally and figuratively speaking. So, what is my next adventure, you may ask? Who knows? I may follow in the McIntyre's footsteps and spend a year in Antarctica. Although, I rather fancy a trip to space. Sorry, Mum and Dad, Isaac is responsible for that one, for having Buzz Aldrin speak in Washington in 2000.
Do you ever feel like a plastic bag?
I'm not sure if I, can you hear me? Oh, you can. Thank you. That was inspiring and absolutely in the tradition of the outstanding consumer lecture. You are a proud member of that pantheon, absolutely.
Thank you, Jeff.
You're welcome. I just want to say that this, as John said, that this lecture has a long history, and indeed, it, as we have all gathered together at the Isaac Conference to talk about augmentative communication, it is the goal of this lecture and presentations by individuals like Fiona to show us the diversity of life and choices and opportunity that exists for everyone. And Fiona, on behalf of Isaac, I would like to present you with the certificate. And of course, the check is in the mail. And our sincere thanks for participating and sharing your story with us. And I hope you do go to space. Thank you. the paparazzi. We're not done yet. Great. Terrific. If you think you had to suit up for Antarctica, imagine. Excellent.
In the tradition of this lecture, I'd now invite folks to come up and do their photos. And
yes.
I think that there perhaps is another Australian photo in the making also.
I think
that
so.
Will be happening. So please come up now before we have to leave the room.
Please, okay. Please come forward and have your photos. I know I've had mine. Proudly.
Yes. It was inevitable.
It was going to happen, yes. Yeah, it's not appropriate to make announcements right now. So.
Hello. If you have photos, remember, bring those photos to the Isaac booth, because we can look at them all at the closing ceremonies. So photos.